The OU on the brilliant physicist who helped shape history, the fantastic Mr. Feynman, in an hour, after we celebrate the creativity of this incredible institution, achieving the improbable and the seemingly impossible. As it reaches 50, Lenny Henry lights the candles to say a very happy birthday, OU.
The 60s, a time of change.
You will not be able to stay home, brother.
But in the corner of Britain's living rooms, another sort of revolution was underway.
Aggregation in the slime mould.
Let's look at some examples of this.
One led by really quiet men and women in tank tops, armed with some bits of cardboard and some massive equations. Their clarion call.
Bum bum.
Bum bum.
Bum bum.
The Open
University. Happy birthday, Open University. Woohoo!
This is its story, with all the highs and lows from the very beginning to today.
It'd never been done before.
It was all so crude.
From a bold experiment that no one seemed to want.
You can't get a degree just by watching the television.
Couldn't bear the idea that the public should be able to be educated.
To the largest university in Europe.
Who created it and why?
And behind some of the BBC's blockbuster series.
We are at a unique stage in our history.
The great thing with the OU is that we can see the tangible results that people are getting.
Here I am sitting with a pen. In my life previously, I'd be sitting with a gun.
For God's sake. I deserved a degree. That's what I felt.
In five decades, the OU has taught over 2 million people. And I'm one of them.
Now, with feeding in this information, here's my input parameter, a parameter S.
What a nice room. I have to be careful on a stage like this because it makes me want to grab a mic and do 10 minutes. It's weird because I don't do stand-up anymore, I do more acting now. And I think that's one of the things that the Open University did. It made me engage with texts more, read more plays, think more about drama and working with other people rather than being on my own all the time. And it's been a change for the better for the most part. But I do miss it sometimes. It's no exaggeration to say the OU changed my life. 10 years ago, I made my stage acting debut playing Othello. I would never have done it if I hadn't done my degree.
No, Iago, I'll see before I doubt, when I doubt, prove. And on that proof, there is no more but this, away at once with love or jealousy.
I left school when I was 16 years old, and I had 7 CSEs, which are kind of like a chocolate fire guard, really. And I was working at British Federal Welders. And then suddenly I got a phone call from ATV Studios saying that I was going to be on television on New Faces the following January. And then suddenly on that Saturday, I was seen by 16 million people and my life changed. This was the big one. In 1998, I was at Warwick University receiving an honorary degree and Professor Susan Basnett made a speech about me that was lovely. And then I got up and made a speech. And then I sat there for 4 hours watching all these students from Warwick University receiving their real degrees. And it was amazing. People were getting up going, woo! And moonwalking across the stage, doing somersaults, walking across in incredibly high heels, big hair, tattoos, piercings, cheering, weeping, exploding with joy. And at that moment, I thought to myself, oh, I don't want this degree. I want that one. It took me 6 years to get my honours degree in English literature. 6 years of not watching telly after EastEnders. Not reading a book without filling it with sticky notes. Basically, the average OU student doesn't get out that much.
My daughter said straight away, oh, you're doing so well, you can't give up now, you've got to go for a master's, but I'm having a bit of a breather for the moment.
I'm achieving the fact that I'm in remission and the fact that I'm now a graduate, so the OU's done a big favour for me.
Well, I've only had this wheelchair a week, so I'm a bit worried that I might crash, so...
175,000 students. Around 4 weeks of graduations, the OU educates on an industrial scale. Fifty years ago, though, the idea of a university being open to everyone, even without qualifications, was revolutionary. And it very nearly didn't happen at all. Ah, the 60s. This is what it was all about, wasn't it? The breakdown of all social barriers, hippies, festivals, student sit-ins. Although, if you weren't an actual student, things were not quite so groovy. The vast majority of kids left school at 15.
Girls like me didn't go to university, and people from where I lived in North London didn't go to university. What was the point?
In 1960, only a privileged 4% of the population went on to university, and most of them were chaps.
And another thing we've got to do in the field of higher education, and this is to put an end to snobbery.
But that was about to change.
Britain that is going to be forged in the white heat of this revolution will be no place for restrictive practices.
Harold made a speech at the 63 conference, much misunderstood. What he actually said was, we shall all be burned up in the white heat, i.e. there'll be mass unemployment unless we plan the economy.
Part of that planning would be an opening up of higher education, polytechnics, new universities. Britain needed graduates. Unfortunately for some, this was going to be all too late.
There were a lot of very bright people who were frustrated that they hadn't had the chance to go to university. But they were married, they had mortgages, they couldn't go back to college, and in any case, there weren't the places for them.
I'd like to study what the intellectuals study.
There were evening classes, of course. Groups like the Workers' Educational Association had helped bring education out of the universities. But they had limitations. They couldn't reach everyone. There was something, however, that could. By the early 60s, 14 million households had welcomed a new member of the family, television.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to BBC Two's game of words and wit, Call My Bluff.
While viewers enjoyed the telly for entertainment, there was one man who could see what broadcasting could do for education. The Russians were winning the space race, and some of their engineers had received a university education without attending a university. A visiting Labour Party sage called Michael Young saw its potential.
I don't think I've ever met anybody quite as visionary as Michael. He had been to Russia and had seen how education was delivered to people living in the most remote parts of the country. And that opened up his ideas to the way in which distance learning could then be translated to the situation in the UK. Michael's vision was really to bring in broadcasting.
Harold Wilson said that before he was elected leader in 1963, following conversations with Michael and building on his thinking, he decided that a University of the Air should be created.
Harold had been doing a bit of travelling as well. In the land of the TV dinner, he had come across an experimental TV college, and it was on a family holiday that his son saw these ideas come together.
He'd been very excited by certain educational experiments that were taking place through the Encyclopedia Britannica in Chicago. And I remember being in the Isles of Scilly. I was still a student at those days. We're at the Isles of Scilly on Easter Day, and between church and lunch, he suddenly decided to map out the whole idea of this University of the Air.
It's designed to provide an opportunity for those who, for one reason or another, have not been able to take advantages of higher education, now to do so.
It was reported on by only one newspaper. It was largely ignored. And it certainly wasn't part of the Labour Party manifesto for the election in 1964.
The politicians weren't working fast enough, so Michael Young set up a pilot to prove it could work.
It was partly Michael's frustration that nothing was actually happening and nothing was moving ahead, that he'd set up the National Extension College as a pilot to really see if distance learning could be high quality.
Nobody seemed terribly interested in Wilson's big idea. And indifference turned to hostility.
Certainly the educational establishment was very much against it, as was the tabloid press. You can't get a degree just by watching the television.
Civil service was very hostile. The civil service wanted at one stage to turn it into the sixth form of the air. They couldn't bear the idea that the public should be able to be educated.
Even amongst his own party, Wilson wasn't feeling much love.
I think there was a bit of a view on the part of some people that this was all going to be for middle-class women. These were the people who'd missed out in the 1950s.
Wilson's University of the Air had become a Cinderella of a project in need of a fairy godmother. And it got one, Jenny Lee.
Degree of freedom that it will give to creative intelligence.
She was the widow of Nye Bevan, founder of the NHS.
Jenny Lee was a miner's daughter who came out of the Independent Labour Party, which was the heart and soul and the campaigning tradition of Labour.
Able-bodied men and women.
She was an MP at the age of 24, before she was old enough to vote in 1928. During the 30s, she married Nye Bevan, and it was only on his death and Harold Wilson, possibly as a wreath for Nye, that he asked her to become First Minister for the Arts. And then secondly, to take over his pet project, which was the University of the Air.
The Prime Minister said, for God's sake, will you take on this university project? And I said, Harold, I'll take it on the same conditions as the arts, that you'll back me when I need money. Now, he never let me down.
I think I only met Jenny Lee once, and then really I was there just to be indoctrinated, really. I mean, she just sprayed herself over me, as it were. I mean, she was a wonderful woman. I mean, she was an icon. She was there for the spirit, for the ethos.
My father's view is that television and other distance learning techniques might be used for diplomas or for individual courses. And Jenny Lee's view was from the very beginning that it should be a full-scale university, and a university where the standard had to be as good as any other university, otherwise it wouldn't be taken seriously.
Liftoff. We have liftoff on Apollo 11.
Red line is lit.
And they're in orbit.
For now. Break shadow. Four forward. Listen, the Eagle has landed.
That was, 1969. The year of the first moon landing, and the University of the Air took off, although it was now, by royal charter, the Open University. And its troubles were far from over. As political battles were being played out on the streets of Britain, the OU faced one of its own.
With a general election in 1970, it looked quite likely from the polls as though a Conservative government would come in, and Ian MacLeod, who was the shadow Chancellor of the Exchequer, had made it very clear he was going to scrap it.
The old system made sense in the circumstances of the 1940s.
The OU couldn't be Labour's pet project anymore. It was down to the academics to prove its worth.
And Walter Perry, who was the Vice-Chancellor-elect of the Open University, one of his jobs was to persuade Jenny to stand back and allow him to depoliticise the Open University for being simply a Labour instrument.
Walter Perry was a heavyweight academic and another no-nonsense Scot.
Anyone who came in an atmosphere of scepticism was putting his or her career on the chopping block, as it were.
He exuded toughness. He looked physically tough. And when you were there, I spoke with a Scots accent, and I want this, and I want that, and, you know, and that was fine. He was fighting his corner, and he did it very effectively.
And round one was a meeting with a future education secretary, the politician who stopped free milk in schools, Margaret Thatcher.
And he argued fiercely with Margaret Thatcher, and he thought at the end of it he had blown it, and he was in sort of pulling his hair out, you know, he's not going to survive an incoming possible Tory government. And they said, no, no, she was just what she wanted. You gave her the arguments, you gave her the facts, gave her the statistics, you were robust. She'll run with it, as indeed she did.
Perry had proved they were serious-minded.
The Queen has asked me to form the next government.
What they needed now were students. They'd expected 25,000. 40,000 applied. It was the biggest intake of any university. They built their own post office. Of course, the last thing you want when you've 30 tons of teaching materials to mail out is a postal strike.
Oh, yeah.
Guess what?
Are you prepared to stay out until we get a settlement?
Yeah! There was a postal strike of 7 weeks. And that meant it all had to be privately delivered through vans and so on and so forth. And I mean, Walter Perry, the Vice Chancellor, was one moment negotiating funding, the next rolling his sleeves up and helping pack boxes of material to be sent out to local study centres to beat the post office strike.
So what kind of people signed up?
A great comedian, Johnny Kennedy. Johnny Kennedy.
I know the OU would love to think that they're going to attract the working man in his thousands. And I really don't think they are. I think they must reconcile themselves to the fact that this is never going to happen.
Now, the first time I came up here was because of football. Because in Liverpool...
Johnny Kennedy joined early on. Like me, he did stand-up and had to fit his studies in with gigging, as I did. But back in the 70s, hardly anyone knew what the OU was.
If I'm reading my book, you know, they'll say, what's that you're reading, you know? I think it's the Playboy Annual, usually, you know. But when they find out it's something to do with the university, you know, they sort of shy away.
What will you do when Jesus comes to Liverpool? And somebody wrote underneath, move Kevin Keegan to inside left.
I met him in 2009 to see how he felt about it all.
I was just an ordinary working class kid in Liverpool. I took the 11 plus exam and passed it and went to a grammar school, which I loved. And that's where I was first introduced to Shakespeare. But when it came time to go into the sixth form, my mum and dad, they didn't see any point in going into a sixth form. They needed me to earn some money.
Yes. I think our generation and the generation before of parents just wouldn't think about, of working class parents, wouldn't think about pushing their kids that way.
Right. When I really did feel cheated by that. And I'd gone down roads that I would not have gone down if I'd gone to a conventional university. And the OU was going to put that right. Yeah. I was going to get the degree that I deserved.
Elbow patches freshly ironed and hair on standby, in January 1971, the Open University was finally open.
And cue.
Good morning and a very happy new year to all of you.
That's right, I'm sad and blue because I can't do...
And everyone was going to get a look in on this university.
Now, do you think that that is what's going to happen on the moon?
Well, I think that's pretty clear what each of these vectors represents.
And then it's a simple matter for you to find the restriction on this height H. Taking a little grease, pull out an eyelash, if I can find one, and get the eyelash into the grease at the end. Right, well, that's how you make the microneedle.
I'd like to consider the features that you might say make up the new and exciting Mannheim sound.
But strangely, not a kipper tie in sight.
Well, I think you'll agree that that's a pretty complicated motion.
In the days when there were only three TV channels and they weren't on all day, the OU had found a home on the youngest and grooviest.
In Conversations for Tomorrow, J.B. Priestley entertains two distinguished guests to dinner.
Part of the mission for BBC Two was to put further education on television, evening classes for the nation.
And let the vegetables just sweat for about 10 minutes.
The OU programmes had been more or less imposed on the fledgling network, and the new controller had to find a place for them.
I wanted my further education programmes to be very attractive. I didn't want to start off with some really boring programme about quadratic equations.
These are the only two possibilities.
So I had the invidious position of having to say, well, I want these hours to do general programmes, and I will stick Open University programmes somewhere where most BBC Two viewers won't mind.
These were programmes for Where the Sun Don't Shine.
But I expect you regard this as all rather trivial.
Kepler's study of planetary motion.
Come with him. And when showbiz met academia, it wasn't always a happy marriage. Colin Robinson directed some of the very first programmes.
We were given the studios which News had just vacated at Alexander Palace. It was stripped of gear, so our engineers had to go out in a lorry, literally, and scrounge bits of kit from other bits of the Beeb to put together a black and white studio.
The OU might have been paying for the programmes, but the BBC were calling the shots.
In social sciences, we're using television essentially for three purposes.
Well, I thought it was very difficult at times because the BBC was an established, well-recognised, well-thought-of institution, and the OU was not.
And could you have John crank the things?
And we said, we're making the programmes, and I did certainly have conflicts with academics over that. And right down to the detail of them saying, I will give my lecture, in effect. And we would say, well, no.
The student, and there is only one student, he's never heard the story before, and he's on his own. And he's sitting there with the telly. The telly's only 8 feet away. Mm-hmm. There's you and there's him. There's nobody else.
Now, don't expect a conventional documentary television programme.
The other thing that is remarkable now is that it was also crude.
That vector...
Very primitive models, graphics where you had to pull bits of cardboard and they would fall over. It was hilarious in many senses.
They were not there to seduce people into knowledge. I will tell you what a quadratic equation is, and this is what it is.
Except that this time I want to solve it using orthogonality.
You rehearsed for 2 days. And then in the last hour, you then shot the whole thing.
He was showing this damn thing off to the left. It looked awful.
Now, the programmes are just under 25 minutes, and we had an hour to get things right.
Take three. Go on, let's do it again. It's much easier to do it now. Let me do it again.
Last time we ended in a state of confusion, to say the least.
The television programmes are simply the cherry on the cake. I mean, the hard grafting is done quite differently. It's not nothing to do with television.
The brains of the OU operation were 45 miles up the motorway in a place that almost no one had heard of until the 70s.
Wouldn't it be nice if all cities were like Milton Keynes?
System is based on roads.
In 2009, I took a rare trip to Milton Keynes to see the OU's HQ at Walton Hall.
I didn't really have much connection with Milton Keynes when I started studying with the Open University, simply because they don't have students at Walton Hall, and you only really post essays here. I used to go and watch Alexei Sale back in the day. He would slightly tease the town planners and say they had to they named things like, you know, the Dave Clark Five Roundabout, Bay City Rollers Boulevard.
A new town for a new way of thinking, if only it were that noble.
Basically, they thought that the Open University should start in a stately home of Britain. And after that, an ideology arose around it that this was all about, you know, sending signals about a new university in a new town. It wasn't, actually. It was just, it was available, it fitted, and therefore they went for it.
In those days, the whole campus was a sort of basically a building site, and in fact there was so much mud around that all the members of staff were issued with slippers that they had to wear around the buildings so as not to spread mud around the place.
It was very difficult to find, and one day I wasn't being very bright, and I seemed to be going round and round the same roundabouts. And there was a little old lady standing by one of them, and she thought I was stopping to give her a lift because it wasn't a particularly nice day. But I said, can you tell me where the Open University is? I don't bleed well care.
Here was a university that most people would have struggled to recognise. For a start, there were no teenagers trying to find where the bar was or sign up for drama soc. Just a lot of academics writing lectures for students they would probably never meet.
Frank, could you sort of summarise very briefly what we talked about at that meeting?
think the most definite thing that came out was a suggestion that...
I mean, there we were. We had a course, team. We had to make a course. Nobody knew how you did this.
Academics were having to bring out into the open their lectures and their other materials, and they got published. And actually, the university did quite a lot to lift the standard of teaching throughout the university system.
Units 2 to 3, Hardy and his influence. Not too happy about that title.
And we had to improvise every aspect of the whole system, of how, what sort of course materials are appropriate for the part-time, distant learner.
Teaching science by post was particularly tricky.
Rock samples for the Earth Sciences course can't be discreetly chipped off with a hammer.
The founding fathers had to put their thinking caps on and really get around the problems of students who weren't used to handling scientific equipment. Now, this is a MacArthur microscope. It's very cleverly designed, and you look down there, and lo and behold, it opens up another world. This was part of a big home experiment kit.
Take a drink from my magic potion. Soon you're gonna really feel fun.
The answer was the mother of all chemistry sets, a lab in a box.
Inside that, those kits were glassware, chemicals, brains, sheep's brains, for instance, so that students could look at the cellular pattern. And we'd have a delivery of something like 7,000 sheep's brains to the campus every year. We became very unpopular with the post office.
I'm honestly not quite sure what one really is going to do with it at this stage.
In the early days, we sent students sound recorders through the post because people didn't have cassette recorders. Now we have them in the bathroom, in the car and everything else. Not then. We even had to send them slide rules. Do you know what a slide rule is? Do you want to see an OU slide rule? There's an OU slide rule. No one had calculators, no one had computers. We had to send this stuff through the post.
Fashions came and went, thankfully.
0.625.
But the OU looked as though it was still stuck in the past.
And the 654?
We made programmes knowing that they would last at least 2, 3 or 4 years. What we didn't realise in the early days was that budgets would not be available to remake courses, and least of all to remake what was probably the most expensive part of the course, which was television.
You're coming from some working men's club and you'd be tired, you'd have a long drive and, oh, my God, it was on in the middle of the... Oh, terrible. I didn't like that at all. Mm.
There was a man with a very big knot in his tie and Johnny Kennedy hair and sideburns talking about quantum physics.
What will we use for alpha particles?
Yeah, okay. All right, stop it.
I watched it because it was comical, but, no, it wasn't for me, basically.
A visual peg on which to hang the detailed mathematical arguments.
We did have the famous Arthur Marwick, who was the historian, and he was known for his cravats.
What is its historical significance?
You would watch a programme just to see how many times he changed his cravat.
But they do not need any obscure theory.
We dressed as we would have dressed if we'd been at a normal university.
To illustrate in visual terms the theoretical work which is discussed in the correspondence material.
Most people had not been to a university, so they didn't know how lecturers looked.
But just let me quickly remind you how it goes.
It's very new for me. I hadn't done anything like that before. I think my programmes were competent. I mean, some of my colleagues were real naturals, and they tended eventually to do far more than their fair share because they did it so well.
We're all accustomed to getting and spending money, but why should somebody give something useful in exchange for pieces of paper and scraps of metal? Here's one way in which money changes hands. Could I have a whiskey and ginger, please?
I was teaching in Northern Ireland in 1970 in the College of Further Education in East Belfast, and I saw an advert for part-time tutors for the Open University, and it had just begun.
Whether you despise it or desire it just for itself, or for what it can buy,
I was a complete amateur. I had no idea how television programmes were made, one end of a television camera for another. I was quite shy. It was quite sort of uphill struggle for me to do all that.
Nowadays, most business is done by handing over cheques rather than by passing over notes and coins.
5, 6.
The OU has always been a boffin's paradise, and as the technology got more exciting, so did the sets, while the presenters
even with simple queries, the SQL processor needs to do quite a lot of work.
And then came a piece of TV technology that meant you wouldn't have to try to stay awake.
This old joke about Open University programmes going out at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. Well, when VCRs came in, video cassette recorders came in, that was no longer necessary.
You could actually send stuff out to students. They could use it. You could even give them instructions and say, I want you to play from here to here, then I want you to stop, read this bit, do this bit, and so on. It was interactive before interactivity became a kind of internet buzzword.
When I first got a video, I couldn't actually record them, so for some reason I couldn't manage to do that.
Remembering to set it, whether it was 12 o'clock midnight or 12 o'clock midday and all that sort of thing, getting it wrong.
There was this issue about how many people had VCRs. At what point could you say that, yeah, now we can send this out because we can expect students to have this kind of technology?
The OU wasn't the only experiment going on in education. The polytechnics were up and running. Universities like Keele and Sussex were creating new ways of teaching. More teenagers than ever were starting degree courses. At a time when 18-year-olds could go to state-run universities for free, the OU, open to all, was making its students pay. Up to £500 for a degree. Not to be sniffed at when the average income in the 1970s was less than £3,000 a year.
I feel that a lot of working class people will steer away from the OU because of the cost of the degree.
Of course, they didn't pay full course fees, but they still had to make a substantial contribution. And I always argued throughout my time, rather later, that it was wrong. Of course, that's all changed subsequently.
OK, John, you can switch it on now.
Finding the money isn't the only challenge that OU students have faced.
Oh, turn it up, look, it's flooding. Oh, thanks.
They've always been trusted, more or less, to get on with it.
Used to get us into trouble occasionally. I got a phone call from the Devon and Cornwall police to say that they'd arrested one of our students for making amphetamines, on suspicion of making amphetamines, and they'd raided his home and found his experiment kit. But what made it worse was that we'd actually written a course unit, the book that went out with the course, called Making Drugs, and they put two and two together and made six out of this. And I had to go down to court and appear in court to say there's no way that using the chemicals in that box you would be able to make amphetamine sulfate. If you could, then I'd... I wouldn't be working here, would I?
You may get some idea of the frustration and of the excitement of scientific research.
Just when I thought I could do it, along came the second unit, and that was on relativity. And that really floored me. And Mike Pence came on the television to tell us we could do it.
So what I've got to do now is to try and shoot a pellet into the tube thing on top of the glider, which is there only to catch the pellet so it doesn't go flying around the studio slaughtering everybody and sundry.
And I thought, he's mad. He's nice, but he's quite mad.
And then there's the question of finding the time to study. What with work, family, looking after your 12 children?
I wouldn't have done it if they'd seemed to be reluctant, certainly.
And they helped you while you were doing it?
Oh, yes, they helped a lot.
What was your...
I think one of the things that students find quite hard is not that they're managing themselves, but they're either managing children or partners or friends.
I always say to my students, real life has a habit of getting in the way of Open University study.
I try not to let my studies interfere with the family life too much, so I do most of my work while I'm at work. While I'm driving my bus, I go through my texts, and all my OU work is done in this way, actually on the bus.
An individual living in complete isolation, like Robinson Crusoe, must do everything for himself.
You are on your own, basically, a lot of the time. I get up sometimes before 5 and study then and then go to work. I work as a dental nurse and I have my notes around me and stick them in pocket, basically.
Sometimes I've had a situation where I had to take laptop into the hospital. I didn't want to defer my exam, my project, so I just had to do it at the hospital.
20 hours of study a week can seriously damage your social life. You can't even watch the TV like everyone else.
How about you there?
Can you repeat the question again?
You need some human contact, and that's where the OU tutors come in.
The first OU tutor I came into contact with was a Yorkshireman, and I remember he said, if you think I'm going to waste my time marking a load of crap on these assignments, well, you've got another thing coming.
A lot of students come and they say at the beginning, I've come because I was in a reading group and I love reading and I read about 3 books a week. And when it comes to it, they realise that reading and being able to write then an academic essay on it is very different from just the pleasure.
The extraordinary thing about the students was that compared to us when we were at university, Open University students were given reading lists and they read absolutely everything on the list and they would come prepared with questions. And I felt on my mettle all the time. I was studying to keep up with my students.
They were very dedicated. The biggest socioeconomic group were school teachers, because school teachers, if they had a degree as opposed to a teaching certificate, got an immediate increase in pay.
If I didn't get an A...
You wanted to know why.
Yeah, exactly. I thought, well, then in all that work I put in, clearly I got something wrong there, because the essay was well written and I thought I've got all the main points and I've had some good things to say.
Johnny, you are so competitive, I can't believe how competitive you are. You are a nightmare.
I'll tell you how competitive I am. I used to go to summer school and work.
Ah, the summer schools. When conventional universities closed down for the holidays, the OU students moved in and started to act like students.
Well, the summer schools are special. Not only did they offer a week-long, a very intense activity, particularly for the scientists working in their labs.
Cleavage along parallel planes.
But also, a lot of our students hadn't been away from home for a week without their partner. And I don't think any research has been done on the number of marriages that actually broke up as a result of somebody studying for the Open University.
It's far too fast, isn't it?
I remember one year all the tutors getting a letter from the Vice-Chancellor saying we mustn't sleep with the students. Well, I was 25 or 26, my students were much older than me. It was unlikely I was going to seduce them, I think.
The students had paid to go there. They were determined to get as much out of it. And they'd even be asking you questions on the dance floor. There was always a disco on the Thursday night when I'd go and shake my booty. But somebody would ask you for a dance, but they'd only ask you for a dance because they had a question they wanted to you to answer as a tutor.
These were hardcore learners, and it was the summer schools that finally convinced the sceptical academic world that the OU weren't mucking about.
There was considerable doubt, and if an academic's only contact with the Open University was to see a television programme or hear a radio broadcast, then that was a limited view. And I think the summer schools really displayed the university at its best, because so many of them were staffed by conventional academics. They realised, you know, they were dealing with a body of students that was equal, if not superior, to the ones that they normally dealt with.
I think the Open University created enormous change in some people's lives. I had one or two women who came to me saying their husbands had told them they didn't want them to go on studying any longer because they were spending too much time over their books and not enough time looking after their husbands.
The Open University is a bit of a toil, rather like having another bloke, but you can't chuck him out.
Some changes were more dramatic than others.
I was in prison. I was in solitary confinement. I was a very angry young man. I was involved in gangs in North London. I was robbing banks. I served 13 years out of 20.
Bobby Cummins has an OBE for services to reformed offenders. But 35 years ago, he was in Parkhurst.
I used to read a lot in prison, and I used to listen to, like, Radio 4. I loved the debates, and I never did that outside. And I started becoming inquiring about myself, you know, why was I different from everyone else, you know? And I started going over to education classes, and he said, why don't you do an Open University? You know, you've got the time, and I had lots of time on my hands. And I thought, here I am, sitting with a pen. My life previously, I'd be sitting with a gun. You know, it was that bizarre, and I thought, what am I doing? You know, I can't really be a student. And there I was, someone had given me, like, really full marks for my assignment, and It was such a buzz. It was better than robbing banks. It was a buzz and a half to know that I could do it, not just some posh kid. It liberated me from crime, because I knew I could do something else.
Let me tell you about a girl who's breaking my heart. She decided lately to get smart. But now whenever I go round to call, she's reading Lawrence and T.H. Huxley with the Open University.
One of the unexpected changes for me was that the OU rekindled my love of libraries.
So in 2000, I sent off the prospectus, and I was blown away, really, by the huge range of materials. They send you all these course materials with titles like A210 and A171 and A300. And it's like they're sending you loads of motorways through the post. Well, of course, I knew all about libraries because my Auntie Pearl made me join the library when I was 9. I had to read Little Black Sambo endlessly. And I got used to the idea of going to Dudley Library on occasion, but then throughout my school career, I didn't really have much to do with libraries, you know. Rejoining the slipstream of education for me in 2000 reintroduced me to this whole world of what is a library for. And it actually takes the fear away. You've got all these books, and you've got people who know where all the books are supposed to go. All the information that you need is right here in the library. And it's more tactile than just looking things up online too, you know.
And we'll be looking at this in more detail in the next programme.
The 80s, and the OU were once again on the political radar, this time because of their teaching material. At a time when books were being banned or burned, when you had counterculture or cash culture, for or against, the Open University found itself against.
When the real conflict took place between the Conservative government and the OU was actually when Keith Joseph was the Secretary of State for Education, and when they became concerned that there were all these left-wing Marxist academics there who were polluting the minds of the students by this left-wing ideology and left-wing propaganda.
Would you like to tell me what this is?
A book.
And its title is Soviet History.
Yes, it's part of the reading from my course.
Do I have to draw you a picture?
Oh, would you? With little lambs running through the
And I'm in deadly earnest. Can't you see the chain? Moscow, Ostend, Dover, Milton Keynes.
Long walk.
Milton Keynes, Anne. The home of the Open University. Don't you realise you have become a pawn of the Kremlin?
There were course team meetings where you actually had to sit down and everybody had to answer the question, is there Marxist bias in this unit, this television programme, this radio? And they actually had to take a vote.
Well, I think the answer is no.
It did cause quite a lot of worry, I think. And Chris Sadoulou was the secretary of the university. Say, it cost him his knighthood.
But in some ways, it was a very kind of fruitful time to be here because there was that sense of pushing against the status quo.
The TV operation had moved to the campus at Milton Keynes, and the programmes were more ambitious.
Take three. Go on, let's do it again.
Might there not be some charity in sin to save this brother's life?
Please you to do it. I'll take it as a peril.
Later on into the 90s, we had David Tennant worked with us on a series called Conjuring Shakespeare. But that was interesting because we went out for that. We actually went to Oxford and shot on location, as we did for a play that starred the then relatively unknown Daniel Craig, and that was The Rover by Afra Behn. It was 3.5 hours.
Had she left me my clothes, I have a bill of exchange at home, would have saved my credit.
It was really interesting to kind of work with people who you've since seen kind of go on and make really good careers for themselves.
As the stars moved on, the days of the old-school TV shows were numbered. And in 2006, we said goodbye to a unique bit of television history.
Nothing to fear but fear itself.
I watched it for a little while. I like to watch things on TV.
We hope that your studies of this unit of...
Those late-night broadcasts in the production centre at Milton Keynes were no more.
team of five scientists are on a mission.
With a myriad of ways to receive teacher material, the TV programmes needed to be less like lectures, which led to a new generation of slick-looking co-productions with the BBC.
Together we are Rough Science.
The Open University of the BBC thought, let's make programmes that are available and accessible to the general public. And I think that came about as a recognition of the responsibility that the Open University has to reaching the wider public, not just its students who are paying for the courses, but it also has an extramural role, if you like. Every university has an extramural department. Ours just happens to be not just UK-wide through the BBC, our relationship with the BBC, but worldwide.
And to discover some extraordinary examples of survival against all the odds, as can be found anywhere on the planet.
The partnership between the OU and the BBC is really important and goes right back to 1971. It's central to everything we do and a source of immense pride. Indeed, it's part of our charter.
In fact, these ideas turn out to be fundamental to the course.
And the broadcasting enables us to reach millions of learners, again, which is part of our core mission, education for all.
I never thought I'd see one of Britain's biggest mathematical brains measuring the coastline with a wooden ruler.
Coast, frozen planet, blue planet. There are dozens of primetime radio and TV shows with a brain. But hang on, how is this going to help anyone to get a degree?
What they offer us is the ability to put our toe in the water and hear serious analysis that help us to take a mild curiosity and turn it into a raging interest.
The OU also collaborates on massive study projects. Like any British university, it does research, and it was an OU team behind the UK's then most publicised step into space, the 2003 Beagle 2 mission to Mars.
Many thought that Beagle 2's parachutes had failed and the spacecraft had crash-landed.
Beagle 2 wasn't a complete success, but the OU built on the experience. Their planetary science department now has a global reputation, and some of the best planetary scientists in the world are in Milton Keynes, handling objects from outer space. 10 years ago, I met one of them.
This is really heavy. What the heck is it?
A piece of our solar system, which then entered the atmosphere of the Earth as a meteorite, which is 4.5 billion years old.
And you can actually examine little slices of it.
But we also have examples of rocks that have come from other planets, such as Mars.
No way.
Our own moon.
That's like a stained glass window.
Yes, it's like a piece of art, isn't it?
Yeah, it's beautiful. But you're not just looking at the pretty colours here. There is a point to all of this, isn't there?
Yeah, the larger picture is that, first of all, we are trying to understand our own place in this universe. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's not very difficult, is it?
In 2014, the OU were part of the European Space Agency team behind the Rosetta lander, which, rather unbelievably, landed on a speeding comet.
The OU's involvement in this absolutely groundbreaking mission was to build one of the main instruments on the Philae lander. Nobody else in the world can build instruments like that. We have one of the largest groups of planetary scientists in the world. We have a mixture of people who use laboratories and instruments to measure extraterrestrial materials. We've got people who do theoretical modelling, and we do people who use telescopes and data from space missions. We are one of the biggest and most significant groups in the world.
And this sounds like science fiction, but it's real. To make computers more powerful, OU scientists are looking into the future, using quantum physics to put information on atoms. The Open University was born out of the space age. It was driven by new technology. While the rest of the world was trying to work out what the heck to do with it, the Open University already knew.
50 years ago, we were really waiting for the internet to be able to deliver education in the way we wanted to. So in some ways, we've always been waiting for the world to catch us up. Reach out, touch space.
Television had let students study at home. The internet allowed them to get out and do it. Where labs once came in boxes, now labs are in cyberspace using virtual reality.
Because the OU does distance teaching, that's our raison d'etre, distance teaching, supported distance teaching. We have to be able to, if you're going to teach science, you've got to be able to do experiments. These are virtual laboratories. There's an electron microscope, there's ordinary microscopes, there's all sorts of other bits of equipment that students can access through the internet and do experiments.
Gone are the old summer schools. This is a world where some students can meet their tutors as avatars.
We've been using virtual reality, and that has been very effective in giving a real-life experience to our students who are at a distance from us. Because they have their avatars, they move around the environment as if they are in real life. It's important for learning, yes, because you can feel the presence of your tutor there in the environment. You also have your fellow students. You can conduct activities together. It's like you're walking in the real space with somebody and going to a site in this field trip. Our students can have the same experience or even better in a virtual environment. It's not just the realism in it, but the non-realism bits, like bringing a cross-section of the Earth and seeing the geology underneath. You wouldn't be able to do it in real life. So a virtual environment also adds to the learning. Virtual reality has come from those very expensive labs to smartphone-driven virtual reality, which I call the democratization of virtual reality. So more and more people can now access it. I hope someday
we'll... The last 10 years have seen growth in the virtual world, but they have been some of the hardest for the OU. Like the rest of higher education, funding from government has been drastically cut. Most of the OU's money now comes from tuition fees, but for the first time in its history, student numbers have fallen by 30% over the past decade. And having once topped the survey for student satisfaction, recent scores have been up and down. So the next 50 years are going to be challenging.
The OU in the last few years has faced a perfect storm. First, government took its eye off the ball for adult learning, and you see it everywhere, concentrating on 17 to 19s in a quick sprint to a qualification that will zip you into the labour market. You'd think we were living in a world in which demography wasn't changing, that technologies weren't changing. And so at a time when we've lost more than half the part-time students in the UK who are mature students in higher education, we have the fourth industrial revolution coming along, in which everybody needs to engage in learning to adjust to a rapidly altering economic position.
To reduce its costs, the OU has made cuts, controversially closing regional centres and reducing the number of courses. While competition from other universities is stronger than ever, and the internet has helped make remote learning more accessible, the OU is still seeking to innovate by investing in FutureLearn.
FutureLearn enables the Open University to reach and target a whole different range of learners than it's traditionally done. So we target professional learners between the ages of 25 and 55, and they could come from anywhere in the world. So we've reached 9 million people who've signed up to courses in the 6 years since we started. One simply cannot build enough universities to satisfy the vast global demand there is for high-quality education. Our ambition is to make online learning a genuinely social experience, maybe not in the same way that a campus-based experience is, but using that social connectivity of the web and improve the effectiveness of online learning by making it something you do together, not just on your own.
Just as Harold Wilson foresaw the need for education to cope with the technological revolution of the 60s and 70s, now the OU is ready to meet the needs of the 21st century.
50 years ago, we were a disruptor in the sector. We started the movement around distance learning, and it's distance learning that is going to open up education for all.
We need to embed lifelong learning in everything we think about. You know, you're not ever going to go now to a job and that's just going to be the end of it. You're going to have to continue to reinvent your skills. You know, I come from a technology background and I see this all the time. you are going to have to understand the world as it moves around you in ways that we didn't necessarily think were so important 30 or 40 or even 50 years ago. So the fact that the OU is dedicated to helping people navigate that journey, to encouraging learning, and to doing it on a part-time basis with support, it just puts it, to my mind, at the absolute heart of how we should think about training citizens, young people, old people, whatever it might be.
Oh, I feel overjoyed. I'm extremely proud, yeah. Well done.
Thank you very much.
I'm really proud.
I think once you start the Open University, that's it. It hooks you in. Education seems to, like, grab me and that's it, won't let me go.
Studying, working full-time, planning a wedding and having a baby. So it's been a very full-on year, but very successful.
So the OU is 15, and I've been a graduate for more than 10 years.
I can still remember graduating with the OU here at the Barbican. It was absolutely fantastic. We all had our caps and gowns on. I got a BA Hons and I was over the moon. It felt like somebody had jammed a pipe up my trouser leg full of lemonade and just gone. I felt absolutely fantastic. Everybody did. We were all so proud of ourselves. It had taken us 6 years, me particularly, to graduate with a BA Hons in English Literature. I was really, really chuffed. And then there was a year's pause, and I thought, now what?
I knew I needed to carry on. I did a master's degree in screenwriting, and that still wasn't enough.
So the last thing I did was a PhD thesis, which was called Does the Coach Have to Be Black? And it was about the lack of diversity in sports films and in the TV and film industries in general. And if anybody had said to me a few years ago, you're going to be doing a PhD in your late 50s, I would have just said, get lost, because I didn't have the educational infrastructure.
I've always had the ability, but it did give me that second chance. It showed me how to use that ability in the most effective way. It taught me discipline.
Open University changes lives. If I hadn't done OU, I would have been back robbing banks and I would have either been banged up for the rest of my life or shot dead.
Without any doubt, it was the greatest achievement of Harold Wilson.
My father was really quite amazed and excited by quite how much it had grown and how innovative it had been.
I think Jenny would be really pleased and thrilled and gratified. She believed that she had given to Harold Wilson a legacy similar to Nye's legacy to the health service.
We believe that where you start in life shouldn't determine where you finish.
This uncertain experiment has touched the lives of millions.
And the weird thing is, I don't think I ever intend to stop learning. Something has been triggered, a blue touch paper has been lit, and I'm on my journey and I'm not going to stop. Why should I stop? With the Open University, you can jump in at any time and start again.
You might like to try that after the programme for yourself.
Fantastic tips on surviving exam stress, getting organised and getting results from Bite Size on the BBC Sounds app. Next tonight, the bongo-playing showman with an infectious enthusiasm for life and science. The OU delights in the fantastic Mr. Feynman. You are this, you are this.